I love this band. Can you imagine what the 80s would have been like without the Smiths? With the odd exception, an idiot parade of posing buffoons, with guitars up here, ludicrous hairdos, singing vacuous platitudes about clothes, status, money. These four blokes from Manchester shone like a beacon in the middle of all that rubbish. They bridged the gap between the demise of punk rock and the beginnings of the rave culture. Their contribution to that most transient and egocentric of decades was to deal with universal themes as relevant today as they were then. Thank God Johnny Marr knocked on Stephen Morris's door that day and asked him to come out to play. In this film, we catch up with Andy Rourke and Mike Joyce, the rhythm section of the Smiths. We follow them across the USA and the UK. We met dozens of fans of the band. And you know what? We found out that two of the biggest fans of the Smiths are Mike Joyce and Andy Rourke.
It's actually exciting to have Andy and Mike here in New York. The Smiths do provide an interesting rhythm section. I mean, songwriting is very important, singing is very important, but nobody really pays attention, gives a lot of credit to the actual musicians behind it.
Me and Andy hadn't been on the road together for about 46 years. You have to have more than a friendship. You have to have like a real kind of kinship. And I've had that with Andy. I mean, you know, I've known him since 82.
I said, I'm a really good guitarist, you want me in your band? And I went, okay, this is just after I left Buzzcocks. And he went, a really great guitarist. And he really said, I was, you know, just having a night out, you know, not auditioning guitarist. And that was Johnny Marr.
I first met Johnny when I was at school, age 12. He had a Neil Young badge on his lapel, Tonight's the Night. And I was like heavily into Neil Young at the time. I think I was carrying a guitar. Yeah, and we just got chatting and said that we'd like meet up in, you know, in school breaks and start playing guitar, learning chords off each other and shit like that, which we did. But we, you know, we were in separate forms, as you call it then. Johnny's form was in like the music room, more of like the more brainy kids, should I say. Yeah. I mean, and I was in like this full of the scallies, basically. I kind of rose to the bait and I became a bit too scally for the class, so there was about three of us that they said were disrupting the class, so they moved us to Johnny's class.
Well, it started at school. I was playing drums with a pair of files, practicing on the desk, getting right into it, and got home and I said to my mum, I want a drum kit, really need a drum kit, and I'd been practicing on the couch as well with knitting needles, and I said, look, you know, to replace the couch, it's going to cost as much as getting me a drum kit.
Every spare minute we'd spend in the soundproof rooms that had pianos in and stuff like that. We used to lock ourselves in there in the dinner hour and just like play guitar, play piano, just mess about, just honing our skills. We didn't want a proper job, you know what I mean? We just wanted to be musicians.
So I've got a little drum kit, started kind of playing away, and then went out into Manchester. Went to see Buzzcocks. I think it was the glee that they exuded, and I thought, right, well, John Marr's my hero. I want to be like him, and just started playing the drums in the bedroom.
Johnny was heavily into like Rory Gallagher. I think that's what kind of instilled in me, like the not aggressive bass player, but a bass player who gets kind of stuck in with melodies and stuff like that. Japan was another amazing one. Mick Karn, who's fucking amazing. I bought all the Japan albums, started trying to emulate that and learn it. Even when I was a kid learning guitar, I worked out how to play along to the radio and play along to records and stuff like that.
First band I joined was a band called The Hoax, and they were based in Manchester. Once I started working with them, that was my first introduction really into being in a proper band. And then straight after that, I joined a band called Victim, who were a massive influence on me as friends, as well as musicians. They were from Northern Ireland. They were just a great bunch of lads to be with.
I was a hippie, you know what I mean? I wasn't a punk. I had hair down to here. I wouldn't say punk passed us by, but we kind of took it in and learned the songs, but we didn't have the right image to go out and actually form a band and be a punk band. When we got to about 17, me and Johnny got a band together. Say it was a band, we never actually did any gigs, you know what I mean? We just rehearsed like hell. Bass playing wise, I was getting heavily into like Stanley Clark, and I just discovered funk basically, and playing with my thumb and getting all masturbatory on the bass, you know what I mean? But again, Johnny was like always in the driving seat, and we did that for about 3 years, and I think Johnny he got itchy feet, and he was like, you know, sorry guys, and I'm gonna have to move on, sort of thing. And I didn't hear from him for about probably 6-7 months, and I was kind of sulking that he didn't want to play with me anymore, you know what I mean? I didn't phone him or anything.
I think that it was youthful egos that got in the way. And I am by no means an old man or anything, but one thing that I have learned is your ego goes out the door once you get older.
Kind of talking about the lawsuit, I mean,
all I can say about it really was it was probably one of the most unpleasant things that I had to go through in my life. It was painful and tragic and really upsetting.
Andy, what's going on, man? How you doing?
You and Johnny have been friends since you were kids, man. I mean,
that's something I would like to resolve, if you know what I mean.
I mean, even if it's not to get the band back together, just to
meet up for a pint and have a chat.
You quite often see Mozza at the gigs. I think he had the long hair and the glasses and a big trench coat on in those days. And he'd be retiring in the corner and that, you know. But, I think he kind of enjoyed it all.
It was like a friend of Richard's, really.
One of the people who swears he was there at the Boscots at Manchester Lesser Free Trade Hall was a gentleman called Stephen Patrick Morrissey, who was one of the many people who came out of the woodwork for those mythical Sex Pistols gigs. A small community got to know one another, and he was on the fringe of it. Stephen, there he is, doing something. What's he doing? Interested in the New York Dolls. Plus point. Interested in Oscar Wilde. Another plus point. And everybody knew he would do something.
A mate of mine, I was living with at the time, a guy called Pete Hope, when I was moved out to Cholton by that point, and he told me about this lad called Johnny Marr that he was getting a band together, and they were looking for a drummer. Did I fancy it? So I was like, yeah, I'll have a bit of that. So I went down to an audition, I suppose, in Tariff Street.
This is it.
Spirit Studios.
Hiya. Yeah, I was in a band called The Smiths, and we rehearsed in here many years ago, about 1982. I'm just wondering if it's all right if we come in and just do a bit of filming.
Yeah, no worries.
All right, cheers, thanks.
I went in and set up the kit. It was Johnny was there, and a bloke called Steve, and a guy called Dale playing bass.
This is the room, but it's a lot smaller. But Morrissey was walking up and down wall like this. He had a long coat on. He didn't look at me. He just walked up and down, and kind of like a caged animal, just kind of striding up and down, just walking backwards and forwards like that. And I thought, right, weird. I won't speak to him. I think I'll stick with Johnny.
Just prior to that, I didn't tell them at the time, but I think I was going out. It must have been a weekend, because obviously I only went out at the weekends, or honest. But I'd partaken of a few mushrooms just to help me concentrate.
And then I stopped playing for a second. And of course, I didn't realise how long it was going to take for the mushrooms to take effect. As I was playing, I looked down and I saw a Saturn V rocket going underneath this side of my leg, round and down that side. So it wasn't even a straight Saturn V rocket, it was a bendy one, like a Dali one. And I thought, right, okay, what's the next song? And I think it was over, because Johnny said, right, that's okay, thanks very much. He spoke to Morris, said, yeah, all right. And I thought, well, thank goodness for that. I'll get on my rocket and I'll go home. And that was it, I was in the Smiths.
And then out of the blue, I got this call from him saying he's met up with this guy called Morrissey, and they've got this thing together called the Smiths, and would I like to come down? So, you know, I was made up, you know what I mean? So I was straight down there. First time I'd met Mike.
So this is one of the lesser-known landmarks in Smiths history. We're in Chorlton in Manchester, and this is where the Smiths recorded a demo in the basement of here, Drone Studios. It's the first time I met Andy Rourke. We came down to do the demo. It was going to be Dale on bass. Got in there, and we had a new bass player.
I'm not sure if Morris was already there or he turned over. He had this long overcoat on and a little bit aloof, but, you know, very pleasant and shook my hand and all that, but didn't, you know, you could tell he was a bit nervous. I was nervous as well. I don't think he was called Morrissey then. He was Stephen, do you know what I mean? And we just ran through the three or four songs. But, yeah, Johnny just kind of jammed them out, and then 10 minutes later, that was it. We were doing a take. We put about three or four musical tracks down, which sounded great to me. I was just buzzing off him, do you know what I mean? And, you know, we all were. And then, as always, Morrissey went in and sort of did his thing over the top. It was the first time it all kind of come together with me and him sort of playing against each other and stuff like that. That's when I kind of found my niche, and I don't think that ever changed throughout the Smiths. I kind of played on Johnny's melodies and accentuated them the best I could. It was like it wasn't me actually playing the bass. It was like I was kind of possessed, and there's just this kind of demon playing this stuff, because there's nothing that I'd rehearsed before or anything. It just kind of came out, you know. It was a pivotal point, and I did kind of know it at the time, because the, you know, when we started playing together, the energy was just there and it was just right, you know what I mean? And everybody, you know, we were all looking at each other going, fucking hell, you know, they're all nodding at each other, you know. That it quite rarely happens, you know what I mean, when there's three musicians all together and it all kind of works, and especially when you've just met.
Because I remember listening to it thinking, this sounds unbelievable. This is good. This isn't kind of, you know, oh, I like this one. This isn't a toe tapper.
And it was a universal thing.
First time I heard the Smiths, I'd never heard anything quite like it. I think I was like a lot of kids that we kind of grew up in that just post-punk, so I never got to be a punk. Actually, the first time I saw the Smiths, I can just remember that weird feeling of just thinking, who the hell is that?
It sounded like the groups that you want to see. It sounded like the groups that you want to be in. And it was like, hold on a minute. I am in it.
It was kind of like a catalyst for starting off a band, really, because, you know, you grow up, and my older brother got me into them. And, yeah, it all started in, like, you know, early 90s. He started getting me,
Say your name.
My name's Preston, I'm in the Ordinary Boys.
We did that demo at Drone in Chorlton, and then we did a gig at Manhattan Sound, which Tony Wilson came to, Richard Boone came to, a few, you know, influential people came to. And then we thought, try and get a record deal. So me and Johnny took a train down to London. We had a chat about things, and we thought we'd rather go for an independent deal than, you know, go for EMI or whatever. So we went down to Rough Trade, which was like a glorified greenhouse, basically, ramshackle place. We walked in, we ran into Richard Boone.
And thought, maybe Jeff Travis, who ran the label, should listen to this. Jeff was about to leave the building. Johnny chased him down the corridor and pinned him against the wall and says, you have to listen to this. And Jeff did.
And we went in there, played in the demo. He was just nodding his head madly. He'd tell straight away he was digging it. I'm not sure it was on that day, but he just said, yeah, you know, we're interested, we'll sign you, basically. You know, it was a big deal us going down there, but we were both so, well, all of us were so cocksure that what we had was fucking special. that we weren't nervous. We were so cocky. We went in there and was like, we've got this fucking great tunes, you know. Sign us up. And I was kind of behind Johnny. Like, yeah, yeah, whatever he says, you know what I mean, yeah.
We were a rough trade, the same label. So they got signed up about just about after us, really. 1981 or something. I liked the first single, I thought it was great. Because the arrangement is Lieber and Stoller, isn't it? That was quite unique for them days. But he used to ring me up, Steve. I didn't really know what he was going on about half the time. He's always nice to me. You know. Well, the thing about the Smiths is they hit a note with a certain sort of brand of people.
I was working at a record store, and to quell the boredom of a very non-busy day, I decided to put on one of the best ofs that was available at the time, just out of curiosity. So I put on the Smiths and became a huge fan ever since. I'm 25 in a month's time, so I never got...
I just want to say I really like your band, mate. I really like your band.
Excuse me. Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
It just all happened so fast. That's why the chronological order of it is difficult to work out, because I think we did like 3 gigs, you know, and we were off. And then it was like single out, and then it was like another one, Top of the Pops, big gigs, America, and it was like, hold on a minute.
The early days, we had a Renault Master, basically a splitter bus. All the gear goes in the back. There's a wall, the front was of that, and you can do what you want with it. But we basically had like a massive mattress in the back, a load of like hippie cushions, and that was it. A few sleeping bags. We went all over the place, and we spent many an hour in that van. Very confined space. We had I wouldn't say a decent sound system in there. There were some very sort of dodgy speakers in the back. We just played tunes that we liked to hear and enlightened each other, you know. Or at the beginning of the tour, we'd have, you know, a box full of cassettes. And then Morris used to come in with, like, loads of mad stuff like Klaus Nomi and stuff like that and play this, and we'd be like, whoa.
Every boy wants a girl he can trust.
And Prokofiev, you know, the Romeo and Juliet stuff that we ended up coming on stage to. All those hours we were stuck in the van were very creative. Also, we'd all bring in different books, and you know, Morris would say, have you read this book? You know, and Johnny got over it. You know, we'd all be swapping books and stuff like that. It's a great time.
Ah, yes. It's a charming 1983. Vintage. Yes.
One of the things that I tend to forget is the age of the band. I mean, Morrissey was 23. And 22, 23, and we were like 18, 19. It's very young. I mean, I can think that now because I'm in my 40s. But I think if you have that gang mentality, it was like we knew what we were doing and nobody else was allowed in. And we were virtually roped together. We'd go out, all shuffle out together, and shuffle here and shuffle there, and just keep it very tight as a band.
I mean, me and Johnny, we always just spent 22-3 hours a day together. It was madness. We started going out for drinks with Mike, just trying to get to know him, basically, and, you know, to turn on to be a top guy. No, I'm joking. There was always a distance between us and Morrissey, do you know what I mean? I think that was good in a way. I think it helped put an edge on the tunes, and we all had a kind of reverence because we knew he was a bit of a delicate flower, do you know what I mean? But we knew he was a genius. We, you know, we just wanted to get the best out of him. So within reason, we'd do whatever he wanted, do you know what I mean? And if he wanted to go out for a drink, then we'd go out. If he didn't, then we didn't. But at that time, myself, Mike and Johnny were trying to get to know each other. And, we, you know, we'd be going out on the town and getting lashed.
You see, I had my own circle of friends outside of the group. So I was hanging out a lot with them. But as the band progressed, there was definitely pulling away from that because it was becoming so intense within the group that my contact with Johnny and Andy was getting stronger and stronger, not so much with Morrissey. Morrissey pretty much kept himself to himself, which I didn't have a problem with. I didn't think it was weird. I didn't think he was being rude. Very separate entity, Morrissey. I always felt as though he just thought I was the beer-swilling monster, which he wasn't far wrong. I didn't really want to go into the world of Morrissey, and I know he certainly didn't want to come into the world of Mike Joyce.
I don't know, I just used to try and make him laugh, really. That was the only level we could kind of connect on, really. As we got more and more famous and he became more of an icon, he was treated with a lot more reverence by other people, and I found myself doing that as well. It was strange, yeah, because, you know, we were all in the same boat.
But Morrissey always knew what he wanted, didn't he? I have a lot of respect for the man, don't get me wrong.
You see, Morrissey, I think, had a very definitive idea of how this was going to go. Again, in hindsight, at the time, I just thought he was the singer. And that's the way it was. He did things that I didn't really get until I thought, that was a great idea. He didn't seek approval. He was going to do what he was going to do.
Well, I never got to see the Smiths live. So if they got back together, that would be great.
Hi, my name is Madden. I'm the DJ here at Live 105 in San Francisco, and really excited for Mike and Andy to come in and chat with us. Frankly, it's so rare that we get a chance to talk to anyone who's been in the band that's had the kind of lasting impact that they have.
Hi, Mike. Hi. How you doing? All right?
Yeah. Live 105 Alternative San Francisco, and I am so thrilled to welcome Mike and Andy from the Smiths here, who are going to be guest DJing tonight at Pop Scene. People started lining up at 8:20 tonight.
When we recorded Hand in Glove, we thought we had a masterpiece on our hands.
And I think it was Johnny's first foray into the recording. I think he must have had sort of like 17, 18 years of ideas ready to explode.
I think maybe the world wasn't quite ready for it. And it didn't make quite the dent in the charts that we thought it would. So we sort of regrouped and had a rethink, and we came up with this Charming Man. And we thought, we can't fail with this one. And as it turns out, we didn't. As a kid, all I ever wanted to do was be on Top of the Pops. When you get on there, it's all a bit of a blur. Everything goes in slow motion. And of course, you're miming, so that feels very strange as well. And there's all these strange dancers who are paid to dance. They obviously have never heard the song in their lives. Very surreal. We had a gig straight afterwards in Manchester at the Hacienda. The BBC laid on a helicopter on the roof that we were going to fly to Manchester.
And it was going to land at the BBC, and I thought, oh, this is fantastic. This is pop stardom.
And Morrissey just went, no, sorry, I can't possibly get in a helicopter. I don't do helicopters. So we ended up getting the train, and it took us like 4 hours. And by the time we got to the Hacienda, the crowd were going nuts, or banging on the floor. But we made up for it. We played a blinding set anyway.
I remember phoning up Tina, my wife now that I'm married to, at the time, because I went out with her for a while, then we split up for a bit. I thought it might be a good idea to give her a call and say, oh, well, I'm doing Top of the Pops. You know, that program that's on. Yeah, you know Top of the Pops. Yeah, well, I'm on it. And then I think we're coming back that night and we're playing a sold-out gig at the Hacienda. You know the Hacienda? Yeah, you know the Hacienda, yeah. Sold that out, yeah. Fancy coming down? And I thought, if this doesn't work, nothing will. And it did.
When me and Brett first kind of started Suede, they were... I think at the time, for me, there was kind of the Smiths. And everything else. They were just our first attempts at songwriting and at making music were dreadful Smiths rip-offs.
As we got sort of more and more famous, which happened very quickly, we found ourselves closing ranks, becoming quite insular and protective of ourselves. And a lot of that entailed us having our own little in-jokes and languages. And I think it used to make a lot of outsiders and journalists and stuff feel very uncomfortable, do you know what I mean? Because they didn't know what we were talking about half the time, what we were laughing at. When we recorded the first album, I think it was Jeff suggested this guy Troy Tate, who was the guitarist from the Teardrop Explodes. I just remember thinking, wow, what a cool name, do you know what I mean? He must be a cool dude, do you know what I mean? And he was a really nice guy.
You come back each night and he did a bit of a mix. He played, I think, Read Around the Fountain. And Morrissey said, is there some kind of high-pitched noise that I can hear on there? And Troy Tate did this kind of comedy fall off the chair to say, oh, he's heard it. Well done, thanks very much. Well, what Morrissey meant was he didn't like it.
I don't think he'd ever done any production before. This was kind of a bit of a break for him. We were a new band.
Now, for reasons that I'm not too sure about, it was kind of decided between Johnny and Morrissey that they didn't want to use that recording. I actually prefer that that version, those versions of the first album.
They did have something special, but that bit of sort of sparkle was lacking in the production. So eventually it was dropped and we tried it again. John Porter was brought in. He played bass with Brian Ferry, amongst other people, and an amazing musician. And he was a lot more forceful in the way he worked.
And so it was redone in Manchester. And with John, I felt a bit too in awe of him, really, I think, because he was, you know, he was a bass player in Roxy music.
The thing with Morrissey, if he didn't get his vocal take in three or four takes, it tends to go downhill from there. John was really good at, you know, picking up maybe the second take, and probably at the time Morrissey would think he could do better and carry on, but John was very good at saying that, you know, that's perfect and we'll stick with that.
It wasn't about production techniques, really, around that time. It was more about the quality of the songs, and the quality of the songs definitely shined through.
Do you know what you're doing on the 28th? Are you still
going to
do this?
Joy
Division,
sir.
Yeah.
Well, they were always like the rivals, our rivals, the Smiths, and when they achieved something that we didn't, I think there was quite a healthy jealousy, really, both ways. I didn't know any of them until after.
Johnny used to play chords to a tune, but within those chords was like a melody as well. And what I used to try and do on the bass was capture that melody and do like a counter melody, which is what I think made like the Smiths songs unique. And since that, my bass playing has never been able to capture that. And I'm not sure Johnny's guitar playing has.
But There Is a Light That Never Goes Out, which is my favourite song. But it's for a lot of people's favourite songs. Like, everyone tries to say some sort of really obscure song, but I think it's more honest. That is my favourite song, and I love it, and it makes me cry.
With the gigs, we played mainly universities. That was the same in America, really, when we went to America. It was just the students kind of went mad for us. The very first time we went to America was in the winter of 1983, I think. We were invited to do a thing at a place called the Danceteria in New York. It was one of the coldest winters on record, apparently. It was like 20, 30 below zero. On the way to the hotel, we thought our ears were going to snap off. And we stayed at this place called the Iroquois, which Morrissey insisted on, because James Dean stayed there like in the 40s or whatever. Mike, within 2 days, he'd caught chicken pox. He had like chicken pox on his eyes, on his tongue, on places that I don't want to even go. Anyway, going back to the gig at the Danceteria, New Year's Eve, everyone's going nuts. And we were about three songs in and everything was going brilliantly. And Morrissey was getting a bit kind of cocky and he thought, I'll take a little walk out. Because there was, well, what we thought was like a bit of a walkway, you know. There was the stage and there was this walkway. So we thought, or so Morrissey thought. But it turns out that it was just the bass bin, the speaker. Morrissey being a little short-sighted, and then there was a gap of about this much. So Morrissey's in between, I don't know what he's singing. And then he kind of walks forward and then he dropped down and disappeared out of view, and he just kind of, the microphone hung in midair and whoosh, like cartoon style dropped down, and it was weird, like he had him crumpled to the floor, and we were like, shit, where's he going? And then he saw like the hands come up and his glasses kind of like this. Like, oh. And he's, I don't think he hurt himself. I think it's more out of embarrassment. He kind of crawled up and he was just like mortified and he just kind of ran off stage. And we were just like, shit, what did we do? You know, we kept playing and like ended the song. And I think Johnny went to the side of the stage and kind of said, come on, you know, come on, Moz, you're all right, you know what I mean? Nobody noticed. And the trooper that he was, you know, in those days, he came back out and when we saw the gig out, and it was a brilliant gig.
I never got into the Smiths, I got into Morrissey first. My brother bought me Boxers, 12-inch single, for my 11th birthday. And I remember just thinking it was really cool because I had a box on the front. I thought boxing was pretty hard. And so I really liked it.
Oh, okay.
And then I kind of, and then I got into all the Morrissey stuff. And I still, because I was quite young, I never knew he was in the Smiths.
Meet His Murder is a real turning point for me. I started to really kind of get where Morrissey was coming from lyrically and his diversity and also of Johnny's musicality. For somebody to write such amazing songs for the second album, the special feeling was kind of a bit tingly and a bit, well, we've had one great album and we've just got done a second great album. And that, I think, was quite an amazing, quite a seminal moment.
We were in a non-vegetarian world at that time, and for instance, going on tour in Germany, I think we did it once, and Morrissey swore that he'd never do it again because, you know, there was sauerkraut and cold meats, basically, you know, and that was for breakfast. It was hideous trying to eat. We all got egg-bound, basically, because all we used to eat on tour was eggs, egg and chips.
Your hour and 10 minutes, 15 minutes on the stage is like, every single, when it's good, every single kind of known pleasure, all like a genie's bottle, all sucked in to like a little bottle like that, and then just taking the top off and going, or and drinking from the elixir, and it's just. Well, you're turning them on and they're turning you on and it's just whoa, waves and waves. It's just one big kind of cyclical pleasure thing. Yeah. And of course the band are getting into it. You're looking at each other going, well, look at this. I've got all about me, you are. And it's unbelievably wonderful. When we recorded The Queen Is Dead, it was a great vibe between us because the band had really tightened up musically. I mean, I had to become a much better drummer than I really was because Johnny was churning out these tunes that were amazing. So you can't just kind of sit there playing away and accompaniment. I was trying to put my interpretation of how the drum part should be. And it wasn't in a kind of cheesy drummer way of thinking, oh, put this top fill. It was just all about what would make Johnny's original riff sound better and to enhance that. I thought with the lyrics, the melodies that Johnny was coming up with, and also the obviously Andy's melody, bass melody. There's very little room for anything else.
When we were recording The Queen Is Dead, I don't think any of us knew that in 20 years' time we'd be getting all this mad attention, like being on the front of The Enemy and people comparing it to Sgt. Pepper's and stuff like that. And it's bizarre. When we were recording, if we thought people were going to put it under a microscope like that, probably wouldn't have got anything done. You know, it's great that all these young bands are, you know, giving us name checks and saying that that was the album that, you know, made them pick up the guitar or the bass or start playing the drums or whatever. After Joe Moss left, we were managerless, and Scott Peering sort of took on the mantle, but the majority of the stuff landed to Johnny, and to a certain extent with Morrissey, would be midway through a guitar taking, we'd get the phone would ring, the studio phone would ring, and it'd be a van hire company saying they hadn't been paid, and Johnny would have to speak to them and you know, say, yeah, I'll send you a check and blah, blah. All those phone calls that we used to get, or Johnny used to get, I think that really frustrated him and got him down, and it got in the way of what we were supposed to be getting on with, which was making music, really.
But you can't have somebody that's in that situation or in that state in the band, really, in any band.
Around the time the Smiths were getting famous, I was still living in Ashton Mersey near the racecourse estate, and a lot of my friends were involved in drugs. And around that time, I got introduced to heroin, as did, you know, all my brothers. And I'm saying the worst thing that could happen to me was, like, I got successful with the band at that time, so I had more money than
than sense.
The first time that I noticed there was not a problem, but I noticed there was something different was when we went down to London for the first time. And we'd been together about a year, and I noticed that Andy was just really funny and really communicative, more communicative, and just seemed to be out of his shell or something, and I didn't really understand why.
My heroin habit had just got out of control, basically. When the Smiths started doing massive tours, I'd get a call saying, right, we're going on tour for 3 weeks. And I'd be like, shit, what am I going to do, you know what I mean? Because I'm going to be ill. So I went to my doctor. They gave me, like, sleeping tablets, Valiums and stuff like that. And as it turned out, those drugs, because I was taking those drugs, they fucked me up worse than the heroin, basically. Especially, you know, if you've got to be on stage and looking sharp, that's the worst things you want to be messing around with. And it all came to a head, an Irish tour, and everyone was like, fucking hell, you know, everyone was really pissed off at me. But, I mean, I was that fucking out there, I didn't even see it, do you know what I mean? It's only looking back, and I cringe now.
We did a sound check, and Andy was, he seemed really out of it. I didn't really know what to do, and he just wasn't with it at all, and we got on the bus after the... I think it was after the sound check it might have been, and Johnny and Morrissey kind of sat with me, and it was sitting on his own, and it's gone too far, you know, we can't have somebody in the band that's this out of it. And you agree. You can't say, oh, well, no, he's all right, because he wasn't.
Caused massive ructions within the band. Morrissey found out about it and he was just like aghast, and I think he put it on Johnny's toes to ask me to leave, basically, which I did. Obviously, you know, I held my hands up and was like, yeah.
It was Morrissey and Johnny came up to me and said, that's it, Andy's out of the band.
Everyone used to score their drugs in Moss Side, and I thought, no, it's too, you know, too on top, too obvious. So I drove all the way to Oldham. It used to take me like 45, 50 minutes every day to this house. And it turns out this house, it was under surveillance for like 6 months, and just by luck, basically. And one day I went in there to try and score, and the fucking doors went down. Like 20 policemen came in. And, you know, I knew my life was over then with the Smiths. I knew I'd be sacked. Well, I'd been sacked, basically. And then when that happened, it was like, oh, my God, you know what I mean? It was on news at 10 and everything. Trevor McDonough going,
yeah, Andy Rourke got elated. It was arrested for heroin.
It was terrible, you know, my grandparents watching my parents, and it was awful.
I mean, I remember the great moment was when I saw you on Granada Reports. Am I allowed to mention that?
Oh, what? Well, yeah, when I got busted.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks for that.
Too. I was sat there with my mum watching, and I went, that's bloody Andy Rourke, I know him. And my mum's going, oh, it's terrible. He must be a terrible boy. I went, he is.
Oh, he is.
There was a point where we actually rehearsed down south with a different bass player. Andy was there with us in the rehearsals, and it was such bizarre. I mean, it was wrong, completely wrong.
That was probably one of the lowest points in my life.
To actually be involved in the addiction is you're in that pit at the bottom of the 40-foot well, and you're at the top saying, well, come on, what's wrong with you? Get up. I can't. I don't want to be down here. I want to be up there with you. I can't get up there.
I spent 2 to 3 weeks just sobbing. I did go around to Johnny's, and he was really supportive, and Ange. I even spent a couple of days at their house, I think, and Johnny was just, like, bigging me up, giving me the strength to to knock it on the head sort of thing, which I did.
It was really tough for Andy. I know that now because I'm 42. It's a lot easier. When you're 18 or 19, you're confused. You don't really understand. You want your mate to be all right, but you don't know the right steps to take. And then, of course, you don't listen to anybody in the 30s or 40s because they're old people, not interested. Same as my daughter does with me now.
Those were very dark times for me. I went abroad for a couple of weeks, kind of sort my head out, came back. I went to Johnny's and Johnny said, you know, we're going to give you another chance, basically.
He came back. And it wasn't that long before he did. So, obviously, a massive relief. That's the way it should be, really. You know, Andy was the bass player in the Smiths.
I think that kind of saved my life, you know what I mean? Otherwise, I honestly know I would have gone under. And we did another kind of world tour. It was brilliant. You know, I was like born again, basically. I was like drug free and just going nuts, basically. We did a massive American tour, playing like amphitheatres and the Enormo Dome, you know what I mean? It was great.
I'm all excited. Want to see Morrison?
All right, have a good gig.
When we recorded Strange Ways, the last album, a lot of people tend to think that there was a bad vibe in the studio. I mean, I've read it anyway, and couldn't have been further from the truth. I think it had the best atmosphere of any album that we'd recorded, because by that time, I won't say we were old hands. Yeah, well, I will. I just did. We were old hands. We'd finally honed the recording technique.
We would record sort of maybe 2-3 songs a day, and we'd have playback sessions till like 3-4 in the morning, drinking crates of beer, and it was great. But I suppose looking back, Johnny was, at this point, he was mulling over, you know, that he was going to probably leave the band, and he knew something that we didn't.
Just when it was getting good.
So after the recording of Strange Ways, a meeting was called for us to get together in London, and we did, in Giles Fish Bar. And it's a posh chippy, that's what it is, really. And we were sitting down there, and Johnny looked... I remember he looked quite ashen-faced, and I realised something was amiss.
Well, myself and Mike, I'm sure, didn't have a clue that what was about to transpire, and I'm not sure Morrissey did. And we'd all just ordered our fish and chips, and sort of midway through, Johnny said, I'm going to leave the band, basically.
The only way I can look at it is, or the way that I can explain the gravity of what he was saying, was you thinking that you're in the relationship's fine with your wife and the kids and everything, and your wife coming in and saying, I've got something to tell you. Oh, what? You burnt the chips. No, I'm leaving you.
I think Mike was the first, as a knee-jerk thing, Mike just said, you know, let's just do one more album, you know.
And I think that's probably the worst thing I could have said.
I think it was the last thing Johnny wanted to hear, basically. He'd had enough by that point. It was a culmination of a lot of things. The pressure of us not having a manager, the musical direction that Morrissey wanted to take was different from the one Johnny wanted to take. The solidarity that we had in 83, 84 had gradually been sort of knocked down by, you know, outside pressures. And I think had we still had that, then the band would have carried on. But we weren't communicating with each other
as well as we should have been doing.
Well, Johnny left, and we tried carrying on, and it didn't work out. I thought it would. I was wrong. You know, Johnny's gone. That was hard enough to deal with. I felt as though I'd taken the place of Johnny. I feel quite difficult going into, because these are quite personal moments. But, you know, I'm going to tell you how it was. And the fact that Morrissey was saying to me, giving me the eye at the meal of, let's have a word, and I'd have to go out and have a word, and he'd say, why are these people eating with us? And I'd say, well, because that's the engineer, that's the producer, and that's the guitarist, that's the bass player and me. I don't want to eat with those people. Well, I found that difficult. I said, well, what do you want me to do? You know, go in there and tell them to piss off and don't eat with us. Well, that was the brief. And that was quite a bizarre thing to deal with. And then when it wasn't working with the guitarist, with Ivor, Morrissey said to me, it's not working. I said, I agree, it's not working. And he said, you're going to have to tell him. And I said, I'm not going to tell him. I don't even know him. I know him from Easter House. That's all. You're the guy that asked him to come and play. And he said, I can't tell him. So I phoned up Ivor, and I said, it's not really working. And he was pretty upset. You know, why? What's the reason why? Understandably. And I said, well, you know, Morrissey. And he said, well, why are you telling me? Why isn't Morrissey telling me? And I said, well, he can't. And he said, right, well, I'm going to go around there and kick his fucking head in. And I said, well, that's probably not the best idea that you've ever had in your life. And he said, well, that's what I'm going to do. And I could understand him being that upset, because he's the guy that got him in, and he gets a bloke that doesn't really know him to deliver, which isn't that difficult. I mean, well, it is difficult to say to anybody it's not working, but you have to say it if it's not. Otherwise, you just walk away and hope somebody else will do it. And that is quite a poignant thing, really, in the Smiths setup. You can draw an inference to why there was a court case. So after that, I couldn't handle working with Morrissey anymore, because it was too confusing and too intense. And then he got in touch with the NME or whoever it was, I can't remember, and split up the band.
It was a bombshell, a massive bombshell, to say the least. I remember just thinking, shit, what am I going to do now?
So the fact that Johnny lasted as long as he did is kind of, you know, all credit to him. But I didn't realise, because nobody could, unless you're there.
I'm still kind of picking up the pieces now, do you know what I mean? You know, I've been in lots of different bands, but I suppose I'm still picking up the pieces from that day when the Smiths split up, really.
It was a great band, great friendship between us all, until we split up, and then a lot of stuff happened after that.
Andy and Mike and Johnny Marr and Morrissey, if they would all get together, that would be the thing. It wouldn't be the same without all of them.
So here we are in the new century, and, you know, the Smiths split up 20 years ago, but the legacy is, you know, stronger than ever. And every day I get up and feel proud to have been in that band.
Its longevity has really kind of affected, well, affects me in a good way, because people speak to me about it and they say, you know, do you mind if I speak about the Smiths? I'm so proud of the Smiths' legacy that I'll talk about the Smiths till the cows come home, because the time that I was in the band was probably the best time of my life.
I mean, Andy and Mike both are really quite... They're such an unusual musical partnership, because, I mean, Mike is a punk drummer. You know what I mean? He can play loads of stuff, but he's a punk drummer. Andy's pretty funky in probably what's regarded as the world's least funky, whitest band of all time.
I travel all over the world, like doing DJing and stuff, and meet Smiths fans all the time, and I really get a buzz out of it, and they do too. At the end of the day, Morrissey knows who I am, Johnny knows who I am, Mike knows who I am, and I sort of know who I am.
Friendships from, you know, years past can be rekindled. With Andy Rourke and Mike Joyce, there would just be another spark, and it would spark into a fire, into a flame, into an inferno, and the Smiths would be back. Just as I thought, I found someone that needs me.
Someone that needs me so much. And just as before. They were the last great British pop band. That's it.
Thank you.